Assalamu alaikum. Peace be unto you. I'm Brother Mandine T. Muhammad. Welcome you to another edition of the Munir Muhammad Show, a CROE media production with you in mind. I was excited to be able to present a platform to bring on guests who will educate you, inspire, inform you, and whatever other good adjectives that we can think of. We've been doing this platform close to 30 years now, and it's a labor of love, as Brother Munir used to say. And definitely, whenever we come on, we're serious about what we do, and educating the community, our community in particular, is something that's very important and near and dear to our hearts. This is a interactive show. The call-in number is 773-434-6625, 773-434-6625. If you're checking us out on the various social media platforms, including Facebook, please like and share the broadcast there. Also on YouTube, please like and share and subscribe so you'll be notified each and every time that we go live. Excuse me. And most importantly, check us out on our own website, CROE.org. Click on the CROE media link. Watch the show. Watch previous shows that we have done. After you enjoyed the broadcast, peruse on around, check out the information that's provided there. And then by all means, scroll on down to that donate button and make a donation to CROE so we can continue to do the work that we do here and continue to provide this platform to various individuals, and also to continue to chronicle the history of the Nation of Islam and the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and the total black experience. So help CROE before you need help from CROE. So also the Munir Muhammad Show, Monday through Friday at 6 o'clock on Channel 25, and our flagship show, Muhammad and Friends, every Sunday night at 7:30 on Channel 19. And you can that Channel 19 show on cable access streams live, so you can check it out from your various technical devices, your phone. And speaking of that, CROE Radio, just download the Radio Garden app on your smartphone, search CROE Radio. Check out the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and students of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad 24/7. And CROE Radio goes live every Wednesday at 2 p.m. And make sure you check that out there. And Founders Day. Founders Day is coming up. Don't have the exact date, but I know it's going to be the second week of March 2024. And so definitely want you to come out and celebrate with us, celebrating Founders Day, our one major fundraiser that we have a year. So looking forward to that. So without any further ado, I have with me brothers there. Pretty much mainstays now, you know, for several years now, and they have a plethora of information to provide to the viewing audience, and looking forward to what they have to say this evening. So joining me again is my dear brothers, Arthur Matthews and Credell Walls of the Cook County Forest Preserves, but they're going to give us their individual titles, because I'm not going to lie to you, if I try it right now, I'm not going to do them justice. So, Mr. Matthews, Mr. Walls, welcome back.
Thank you.
What's your title again? What are you doing now?
It's good to be here, first of all.
Yes, sir.
So, my title is, I work for the Department of Conservation and Experiential Programming, both of us.
Yes, sir.
My title is Operations Manager.
Okay.
So, I make sure that all of our staff have the resources that they need to do their job.
Yes, sir. Okay. That's very important.
Very important.
And Mr. Walls? My name is Credell Walls. I go by CREE. I'm director of Sand Ridge Nature Center, one of the six nature centers for the Forest Preserve of Cook County.
Yes, sir. And you're the one, your facility has the blind owl.
So our we do have an owl that has a neurological condition. but just to follow up on that, Sand Ridge Nature Center is a campus.
Yes, sir.
So we have an aquatic center and a campground attached to it, Camp Shabona.
Camp Shabona, wonderful. But all jokes aside, though, I mean, the owl is pretty popular, and people come there from miles away to see that owl. But I'm looking forward to this conversation tonight, stemming from my last conversation, because, you know, it's cold outside, man. I know I was rushing to get inside of here under these hot lights just to complain about the hot lights. But, you know, but this is a busy time. In the Cook County Forest Preserve,
that's right.
Much to my surprise, and it's going to be a surprise to many of the people that's going to be viewing us this evening, but we're going to be talking about that, some of the activities that will be taking place during the wintertime in the Cook County Forest Preserve, among other things. So just let's jump on into it, man. So because most of the time when you think about, you know, Chicago, especially Chicago winters, you know, nobody's thinking about going outside and enjoying nature. thinking about staying in and cutting up with a good book, or, you know, if you have to go outside, make sure you got your long johns on and your heavy boots. But people may have their long johns on and heavy boots, but they're doing things in the forest preserve. So, but let's get into it.
Yeah, so I'd like to start by saying, you know, nature is alive in all seasons, you know, whether it be winter, spring, summer, or fall. So winter is just as exciting as any other season in the forest preserves.
Yes, sir.
Just to remind people of all the assets that we have over 350, I should say, assets you have as a taxpayer in this county. This all belongs to the taxpayers. So we have over 350 miles of trails, multi-use trails. That's for walking, for running, for horseback riding if you have a horse, for jogging, you know, for biking, riding bikes, cross-country skiing. We have 40 managed lakes. In the wintertime, we do allow ice fishing on certain lakes. So you just need to go to our website to find out what those lakes are, as well as fishing. So it's just a myriad of things that you can do.
Cree, before we come to you, and I'm sorry to cut, but it was something that you had said that we, somebody asked about last time, but we forgot to circle back around, and you brought about the horseback riding if you have your own horse.
Right.
So you all don't provide any horses.
We don't provide any horses, no.
Okay.
But our trails, some of our trails are mixed use, which includes horseback riding.
Okay.
Yeah.
So when you say mixed use, it's even horseback riding.
Horseback riding. That's
so
right.
Horseback riding, bikes, walking.
So let me ask this.
Right.
So if I'm out there on in the Dan Ryan Woods, and all of a sudden I see somebody on a horse, that's perfectly legal.
That's perfectly legal.
So do they have to get a heads up first?
Is Dan Ryan Woods a site for horseback riding?
Yeah. And see, everything goes back to our website. You need to go to the website. If you do have a horse, I urge you to go to our website and find out what are the trails that are
horse friendly.
Yes.
And not only horse friendly, but also because do they have to inform the particular site that they're coming in? I mean, if I'm out there, you know, the singers out there already with golf clubs and everything, all of a sudden they hear, you know, some hoofs coming up my hand.
No. Well, see, you bring up a good point. There's what's called trail etiquette.
Okay.
And that's all on our website as well. You want to know who to give way to. You know, you don't want to scare an animal, you know, like a horse. So if you're on a bike, you don't want to toot your horn, you know. So it's all kind of trail etiquette that you can learn from our
website.
And
I promise I'm going to let you jump back in. But when you talk about trail etiquette, you know, because sometimes we're on the trail and somebody is coming flying by on a bike. Now, there are some people who may have a bell, or they'll say, you know, on your left, on your right, coming through. Mm-hmm. Sometimes, just by the grace of God, nobody gets ran over because they're just fly on by on the bike. So a lot of people don't really have trail etiquette.
Yeah,
so
they have poor trail etiquette.
Very poor.
And, you know, sometimes when we do learn about certain areas where there might be a problem, we try to do some kind of program there. So we'll put signs up, or during the summer or some time of year, there were moments when we had volunteers out where we would just pass out trail etiquette flyers so that people can still get that information if they're not going to the website.
Yeah.
But very seldomly, but sometimes you might have those speed racers.
Yeah. Yeah. So when you thought about that, it triggered something. Mm-hmm. But we're talking about the some of the activities. Did you mention snowmobiling or snow?
I didn't mention it, but if you own a snowmobile, there are areas where you can snowmobile as well.
So, you know. And again, so just like with the horses, you all only provide certain things. I mean, if somebody has something already, that's different.
That's correct.
And then, again, it may not be conducive to every site.
Every location.
That's right.
So, I mean, what you're bringing up makes me think about what we do provide, right? Mm-hmm. So, like, you can rent boats. Mm-hmm. We provide boats. We provide...
Well, in the wintertime, we provide
camping gear.
Camping gear you can rent.
Okay.
We provide snowshoes free of charge on a lending system at various nature centers. Not all of them, but at most of our nature centers, you can get snowshoes. Now, there has to be at least 4 inches of snow to use snowshoes.
Yeah.
Okay. And also at our campgrounds, we provide snowshoes.
Yes, sir.
But it must be 4 inches of snow to use them.
Now, as a city boy, when you say snowshoes, I'm just assuming I'm putting my boots on, or are we talking about something else?
Oh, no. we're talking about things that go over your boots.
Okay.
Right.
So the snowshoes kind of distribute your weight evenly so you don't sink down into the snow.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's a new experience for most people.
And so one will utilize the snowshoes to do what? To go hiking or just to walk in the snow or?
Both combined. Mm-hmm. So you're hiking on the snow. So instead of if you didn't wear the snowshoe, your shoe would go into the snow. Mm-hmm. But with the shoe, which is kind of on top of a tennis racket and a small grip, you can walk on top of the snow.
Right. So they really do use tennis rackets.
Well, they're a little bit more modern now.
Okay.
Yeah. But the older ones did look like tennis rackets.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
So that visual is still in our heads, you know.
But again, one will have to visit the website to see where you can, because I mean, because some places may provide a better scenery or more challenging terrain.
Just different scenery, yeah. Every nature center has a different sort of surrounding, different habitat, yeah.
Okay.
I mean, but most importantly, do it on a day when there's a lot of snow, because then the shoes will be available.
That's okay. Right. Okay. Right. So what else? I mean, what else could one look forward to during the wintertime? Boy.
So let me stick with the snowshoes for one more second.
Okay, cool. Take
your
time.
One of our six nature centers, specifically Sagawa, that location, they have sort of a mini ski resort, right? So you can rent skis there. And all of their programs for the winter, not all of them, the majority of their programs for the wintertime is all about how to learn how to ski. Mm-hmm. So cross-country skiing 101, and it's just basically learning what it means to cross-country, which is just using skis going in a straight line.
Okay.
There's no, like, drop or anything like that.
And you mentioned, did you say resort?
I said a mini resort. It's not a resort at all. It's one of our nature centers that has a ski program.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, because I was about to say, so the people don't necessarily have to go out of town to, but you're saying don't.
Well, they don't.
It's a ski lodge.
Ski lodge.
And a nature center.
So they can, just like we mentioned last time, so one can actually stay there.
Yeah. Well, you can't stay there, but you can rent skis, as Cree was talking about.
Yeah, and the whole about, I mean, there are campsites nearby they can potentially stay at.
Hmm. Right.
But I was also kind of jokingly saying that, well, they can get a hotel nearby.
Okay.
Right.
And then come on over.
Yeah.
And then go back.
Yeah, yeah. We're talking with our dear brothers, Creedell Walls and Arthur Matthews of the Cook County Forest Preserve. If you have any questions or comments, and I'm pretty sure that you do, the number to call in is 773-434-6625. Again, that's 773-434-6625. And you know, it's we talked about so much last time in regards to the activities that's, like you said, nature is year round. Mm-hmm. And people still get out. I mean, as cold as it is, I mean, I still see people walking around and, you know, they're bundled up. You know, they're not necessarily jogging like they used to, but they are still getting out there.
Right.
And so it would be to their advantage to really get out there and to see what, you know, one has to offer, because it's, I think we talked about this also as far as it being therapeutic, you know, and I know how it is when the sun is out. I don't know with the snow and everything, but for those real nature lovers, you know, and I'm pretty sure just because, you know, I may be reluctant, or a lot of city dwellers may be reluctant. There are a lot of people that look forward to these different activities, right?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so speak to that.
And, some people, like you say, enjoy the wintertime more than the summertime, perhaps. You know, it depends on what your favorite season is. Mm-hmm. But, you know, there are different animals that come out in the winter. Some that come out all year round. Some, you know, lie dormant in the wintertime, like insects and that. Mm-hmm. So winter is a good time to come out because there's no insects, no bugs flying around.
They
you know,
back
so
to the hell
that,
they
that's
came
one
from.
Good thing.
Yes, sir.
But you still get the mental fulfillment, you know, and the relaxation and the fresh air when you just take a walk on one of our trails.
Yeah.
You know,
and also, if you're really missing the summer, or if you're a big camper, at our campsites and actually at Sandridge Nature Center, we're having bonfires. Mm-hmm. So you have a large fire out there with hot chocolate, some activities that people can still be engaged with. And some of these bonfires will start when it's light outside, so you still get the feel of being out in the summertime with that cold breeze, but you also smell the smoke from the fire that reminds you of the summertime. And then you can have a cup of hot chocolate. while you're out there and participate in these smaller activities that are geared towards the outdoors.
Yeah. You mentioned also about the different animals that may come out mm-hmm. during the wintertime as opposed to summertime, and some come out year round. Mm-hmm. So is there like a tour, you know, for some people, or a tour just someone to talk about that? Is there an expert that know which animals that are coming out and what's what?
I mean, there are some programs with our zones and some of our nature centers. We all do programs that talk about animal tracks. So when you're walking in the snow, you can see different footprints mm-hmm. from certain animals, and they'll show you and say, this is a raccoon footprint, this is a deer footprint, let's walk and see if we can identify these different types of animal tracks in the snow. Mm. You can also do that with scat.
With scat?
Poot. Poop.
Oh. Yeah, the scientific term.
That's right. Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, and a tracker would definitely know, you know, which animal is out there due to that. Okay.
That's right.
That's definitely interesting. So, I mean, I don't want to hold you back. Go right ahead.
And then there are also some other programs where you have people use their cell phone to take photos of different leaves that you'll find out in the forest preserve that are covered in snow, or whatever that instructor would gear you towards taking photos of. Hmm. So those are other types of activities that are happening. And there are quite a few group hikes. We know that people now enjoy going on hikes with groups versus by themselves. So different locations have hikes that you register for that involves someone facilitating that hike, pointing out different wildlife, different types of trees, and different things along that hike. And usually the hike's up to an hour and a half.
And you mentioned cell phone pictures. Like if someone, you know, like say for instance, a television show wants to do some filming or some photography, you know, from a particular individual, do they have to reach out to the authorities, with you all, to get that clearance first? Or how does that work?
Yeah, we've had, you know, production companies come out. They have to set something up through us, through our permits department, use the space to film. Now, if you're just photographing, you don't have to set that up with anybody.
Right.
You're just free to go out and photograph whatever you like. We actually have a photography, what is it called? We produce a calendar every year, and all the pictures are photographs that the public have taken. And we have a contest every year, and the winners of the contest are the pictures that are chosen to be in our calendar.
And these are photos taken on Forest Preserve property.
That's right.
And so that's something also, I mean, so do you all provide like a class for people to take? Say if that's something that they're interested in and they may not know, you know, may not have the knowledge of how to do it, is there a class or something that they could take to be able to take, you know?
That's a great question. I mean, we don't have a lot of classes, but we do have some sites that might offer like the cell phone photography class. That's a class for anyone who's interested, and most likely the instructor will say, let me pose some challenges to you on taking a photo, you know, with your knee down
right, and then to know what to look for to know where to look, you know, because a lot of people will probably be interested, but they, you know, they're just walking around and they're probably loud, you know. Somebody with more experience, like, well, you know, you got to be easy, and
if you want,
and
so, and also to that point too of photography classes, this is a two-pronged thing I'm about to share.
Yes, sir.
We also, the Forest Preserve, we have a partnership program where people that are interested in providing different types of services for the Forest Preserve, they apply through our grant program. You could probably speak to it better, but I know someone who will apply to teach a series of photography workshops. More so nature photography to do just what you're talking about.
Yeah.
But I'm sharing that to say that if you go to our website, you look under how to partner with the Forest Preserve. If you have an idea of what you might want to do with the Forest Preserve, whether it's meditation workshops, if you want to partner or work with some of our existing events for your program, we could work with you on that. There's a small stipend tied to that, and it's an application process.
Okay. Yeah. And I know you all mentioned the website a couple of times, but what is the website?
So the website is fpdcc.com. Again, that's www.fpdcc.com. cpdcc.com.
Okay.
For Forest Preserve District of Cook County.
Did you have something to say? He had mentioned the grants. Do you have something to say about the
grants? Well, I just wanted to say, yeah, that's a great idea, because we don't technically offer a photography class, but as Cree was saying, if you are a photographer and you're really passionate about, you know, showing people how to take photos, or you might be just passionate about wildlife, photographing wildlife, I encourage you to go to the website and go to the section doing business and apply.
So you're saying that it's a possibility that the Cook County Forest Preserve will provide a grant for one to teach that class?
Yeah, or a stipend.
A stipend.
Right. To teach that course.
And just to be clear, there are different types of programs that people can pitch through this partnership program.
Okay.
We've had we consistently, every year now almost, we have a group that do our lead Underground Railroad tours. Mm. We just wrapped up a Capoeira Afro-Brazilian Martial Arts workshop.
Yes,
and we also had someone do a 3 series of art and nature retreat at Camp Shabona. So there's different types of workshops that people can say, hey, I would love to do this at Sand Ridge or at this preserve for the public.
Yes, sir.
And it's usually free.
And that partnership, I know you mentioned that before, but it just dawned on me really what you all were talking about. But we need to dive more into that also. But we do have a caller that's been waiting.
Okay.
So, caller, you are on air. Caller?
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening, Mandina, and good evening to your distinguished guests once again.
Yes,
I really enjoy when these guys come on and explain what's going on with the Cook County Forest Preserve, which I feel is vastly underused by the black community for sure, because I think that, you know, we just kind of like to overcrowd Dan Ryan Woods instead of going out and experiencing some of the other facilities. But when you mention winter activities, you know, growing up as a boy and young man, one of my favorite things to watch on TV was A Wild World of Sports, you know, and, you know, that guy, they often show the winter stuff, you know, that guy who falls off the ski jump, the agony of defeat. But anyway, the point is that I really loved watching winter sports, you know, the skiing and ice skating, and it all looks so beautiful, you know, but I just never imagined me doing anything like that. And even ice fishing. Do y'all offer anything like ice fishing? Because I heard the Park District does, but it seems like something that black people just wouldn't do. So tell me, are we getting involved in this the way, or are you just wanting us to get involved in this? Because I just don't see us doing it, but I would like to try.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, brother. And but before you answer, I think that's an excellent point, because, you know, the Dan Ryan Woods and black people is almost like synonymous. Mm-hmm. You know, you never hear black people talk about going any place else in Cook County other than the Dan Ryan Woods. So that is something, because, I mean, let's just be honest. Well, you mentioned the other places, and it's not just that they're located elsewhere in other suburbs that we may not necessarily be at, but it's not like we can't get to it.
That's
though.
Right.
We go every place else.
Absolutely.
You know, we're standing in the lines out there at the outlet mall for the Gucci store, so we can definitely get to other places. So, but I wanted to speak to that.
But you know what? I appreciate that comment and statement about Dan Ryan Woods. That just makes me think about how what we could do is, when we have the different programs of Dan Ryan Woods, we can do a better job of promoting what's at the other locations nearby, so that they are aware that it's not just here, it's everywhere else. Not just give them this, but to literally, you know, give them better information so that they know that they can go to Sand Ridge, they can go to Swallow Cliff, other areas on the south side near them.
And I think that's a good point, because we get a lot of people, a lot of black people, they go skiing. I mean, they can at least get their practice in.
That's right.
You know, here, they always talk about zip lining out in other countries, so they can, you know, get an experience you know, here. So I think, it's always room for improvement no matter what we're doing.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, I appreciate that,
I just want to say that I think it's great that we still support Dan Ryan Woods and use Dan Ryan Woods, because if we don't use it, then those things go away. You know what I mean? So that's a good thing that people still use Dandelion Wood. But again, like you said, we need to promote our other areas, you know, because every nature center that we have is free.
Yeah.
And they're open, all of them are open 7 days a week.
Seven.
A nature center is a good place to go just to learn about all the other things that we have to offer in the forest preserves, because they have literature there. They have people that are educated in habitats and animals, and just very, very informative people at every single nature center.
Excellent.
So that's a good place to start.
And also, to Art's point, if you are someone who's nervous about being out in nature, go to one of the events or go to a nature center to give you that easier and nicer exposure. Mm-hmm. Because once you do that, you'll eventually want to just go to a preserve on your own.
That's right.
And this is definitely for you if you're nervous or uncomfortable about going out into public.
Yeah.
I'm going out.
Yeah. Gotcha. And I think we do have another caller. And the number to call in is 773-434-6625. Again, that's 773-434-6625. And I hear you breathing, so caller, you're roaring to go, so go right ahead. You're on the air.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
Good evening to your guests.
Yes, ma'am.
I live out in South Holland, and I would like to know about the camping, the overnight camping that you can go to. And I also want to know if you decide to camp overnight, will the forest preserve have security to, you know, go around to make sure everything is okay? Thank you.
Thank you so much.
So, first of all, she lives in South Holland now. There is Camp Shibona, which is connected. It's a campus connected to Sandridge Nature Center, of which CREE is the director. But unfortunately, Camp Shibona is a three-season campground.
Yes.
So it closes October 31st and it opens again April 1st.
Oh, wow.
Okay. So if she wants to go camping in the wintertime, she can't. The closest would be Camp Sullivan, which is in Oak Forest, Tinley Park. 147th and Oak Park Avenue.
It's not far.
It's not that far.
Right.
Yeah. Now, at Camp Sullivan, we've got bunkhouses that sleep 36 people with their own kitchens and dining space, right down to cabins that sleep 8 or 10.
Mm.
Or, no, just 8. And those cabins are not heated, though. The bunkhouses are heated.
It's going to be some real outdoor living, huh?
Yeah. So,
do they at least have a fireplace?
No. The bunkhouses are heated.
Okay.
No fireplace. The 8-person cabins are not heated, and there's no fireplace. Now you can build your own campfire outside of it.
But what about when you want to go to bed?
And the smallest bunkhouse sleeps 16.
Okay.
Okay, so she may be interested in something like that. But we're talking about camping. You got to rough it. You know,
man. Well, bring on space heater, man. Go ahead, Chris.
No, I was gonna say, believe it or not, if you are a camper and if you have a really good sleeping bag, you will sweat out there.
You really will.
And I know from personal experience, the sleeping bag will matter.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Because it'll cut the wind off of you. You know, that's what you really want. You don't want the wind on you.
Gotcha.
But a good sleeping bag, as Chris says, will keep you warm.
Is that something you all? No, I don't think y'all really want to provide a sleeping bag.
We provide sleeping bags for camp. We do have a camping program at Sullivan, as a matter of fact, called Camping Leadership Immersion Course. With that course, if you're part of a group, we'll teach you how to camp.
And that's what I was going to ask also. I'm sorry for cutting you off.
Yeah.
Because that may be something, because a lot of people, again, a city dwellers, I mean, you said if you get a good one, I mean, because most people just probably grab a sleeping bag, maybe like a long pillowcase, and just get in that. So, but you're saying maybe it's like a class. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, a tutorial, you know, what to get, you know.
Yeah. Right.
You know,
what to look for.
Exactly. Yeah.
So. We have, tutorials on building a campfire.
Mm-hmm.
Not everyone knows how to build a campfire.
Right.
So if you do go to a campground, each campground has its own fire pit. But if you don't know how to build a fire, that's not going to do you much good.
Right.
But we offer, like you said, tutorials on how to build a fire.
Nice. And also, we do have, our winter guides are now out.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And we also keep the PDF version of this winter guide on our website. Our campgrounds, I believe they're offering a Camping 101 workshop that will teach those very things Art was just talking about.
Yep.
Cool.
And we'll also hit on, you know, how to dress for the winter.
Yes.
You don't want to just go out and take a walk on a trail not dressed properly, not properly layered, you know. So it's all about dressing right for the cold.
Yes, sir.
You know, it's nice to be out there, but you got to be warm.
Yes, sir.
If you're not dressed right, you won't enjoy it.
That's right.
Period.
Yeah.
What we're going to do, we're going to take a break right now, and we're going to pay some bills. We're going to take a break, pay some bills. And but I do want to remind those that, that are interested, if you have a business or organization or something you want to promote, give us a call, 773-925-1600. And let's sit down and talk about how we can better provide, help you promote your particular business or operation. And so let's chop it up. So in the meantime, check out some of these other people who are utilizing our services already, and hopefully that will interest you as well. So we're going to take this break, and we're going to come back and speak more with our guests. We'll be back.
I'm Dr. Ansel Johnson, Clinical Director of Vision Salon Eye Care Associates. And here at Vision Salon, we connect your eyewear, your eye care, to your overall health, because we know the eyes are the windows to the soul. We manage many common conditions like diabetes, hypertension, and glaucoma that can jeopardize your eyesight.
At Vision Salon, our friendly and professional team of staff and doctors are here to serve your needs with compassion and care. We manage adult and pediatric patients as young as 6 months.
And we have specialty lenses that can help you see much more comfortably on the computer and in your car, managing the glare, managing the sunlight to protect your eyesight. If you're living with diabetes or been told that you are borderline, you need to see us so we can make sure that your sight stays with you for a lifetime.
So come visit us at Vision Salon. We'll be happy to care for you, your family, and your eyes.
We wish you to be well, see well, be blessed. My name is Dr. Ansel Johnson, and we are Vision Salon Eye Care Associates.
Hi, I'm Spencer Leake Jr. In 1933, with the help of God, my grandparents, Reverend and Mrs. A.R. Leake, founded the A.R. Leake Funeral Homes. And now, 75 years later, under the leadership of my father, Spencer Leake Sr., I serve as vice president. While away in college, my professors often told my class that third-generation funeral businesses usually fail. Well, with the help of God and your help, my family and I have proven those professors wrong. So on behalf of my mother, Henrietta, my father, Spencer Sr., our family, and our entire staff, we would like to thank all of Chicago and its suburb for 75 years of your trust and support. If you should ever need the services of a funeral director, won't you consider calling us? We are located at 7838 South Cottage Grove and 18400 South Pulaski in Country Club Hill. Leake & Sons Funeral Home, large enough to excel in the field, yet small enough to have patience and understanding.
Explore the natural beauty of thousands of acres of wild and wonderful for an hour, a day, or even a night. Enjoy the forest preserves of Cook County, more than 350 miles of trails. Spend the night camping, go bird watching, and so much more. The forest preserves are a place where native plants and animals thrive, and they help make ourselves and our communities healthier. Learn more and plan your visit at www.fpdcc.com.
And we are back to the Munir Muhammad Show. I'm Brother Mandine T. Muhammad, enjoying a wonderful conversation with my brothers, Creedell Walls, or Cree as we affectionately call him, and also our dear brother, Arthur Matthews, both of the Cook County Forest Preserve, talking about opportunities, you know, all type of opportunities dealing with the Forest Preserve. And you know, again, you know, I'm glad Brother Emmanuel called in, because really it's like, it's a lot. And just, we as Black people just don't utilize anyway. I mean, it's almost like, you know, when you hear people and we so used to hearing it, it's like we should be really upset about it. You know, when we hear like young people, we know young people that's, they don't even get off their block, or they don't even get off their neighborhood. Right. You know, never been downtown. Okay, that's downtown. Downtown is, it's great to see, but you get something like, Dan Ryan Woods, you know, mm-hmm. even though we joked about that, that's like synonymous with Black people, but you got a lot of young people that have never been there, aside from a family union or that's something right. like that. Yeah. But have they just, with all the music is not playing and, you know, the ruckus and all of whatever else they do, you know, have they just, you know, had the opportunity just to walk around, mm-hmm. you know, enjoy nature. So that's mm-hmm. something to think, because you see people, other people, they utilize the heck out of stuff, man.
That's right.
You know, I mean, I mentioned downtown, I recall being at the cultural center down there, mm-hmm. and they have all type of stuff in the information, you know, section. You know, mm-hmm. they got what's called city passes for yeah. Chicago, and you know, you can get discounts at different spots. You know, it's all type of things that's being offered in the city yeah. that we just don't know about. And I think the same thing can be said about the Cook County Forest Preserve, because even at the Dan Ryan Woods, I think we mentioned off air about the facility there.
Right.
I can't think of the name of it.
Visitor center.
The visitor center.
Yeah. It's pretty new. I think we completed it a couple of years ago.
Yep, a few years ago.
The visitor center. So I really encourage people to go inside
yeah.
and talk to the staff that are in there, and maybe pick up a brochure, one of these schedules. You can pick that up there, or maybe a zone map. Hmm. I love telling people or encouraging people to use our zone maps. We have 5 zones, and you can get these online as well at our website. But it gives you points of interest in your zone, in your area. Mm. So if you live on the South Side, there is more than just Dan Ryan Woods. Mm-hmm. You know, there's Sandridge Nature Center, that whole campus. There are trails, miles and miles of trails with it. There's beautiful scenery on the South Side yeah. of the city or of the county.
Yeah.
So those zone maps are important and yeah. they're a really good tool to use.
And also, just to add to the visitor center, you can also, they can still get their permits at the visitor center. Usually people go to general headquarters mm-hmm. in Oak Park.
And when you say permits, you mean like?
Permits to reserve space for yeah. a preserve.
Yeah.
Or to do, not photography, but to do any type of video mm-hmm. related mm-hmm. things.
So does the permits, right. does that entail also, you know, like for get-togethers and things of that sort?
For gatherings, yeah.
Yeah, so
if
they can do
25 or more
over
people.
Over 25
because,
people.
Okay, because yeah. there was a time that you have to call in or go down to a particular facility downtown.
That's right.
But so that's not the case anymore.
You don't. That's what he was alluding to. You can do that actually at Dan Ryan at the visitor center.
Okay.
You can put your permits in through there.
Okay.
Whereas you used to have to go all the way down to River Forest to our national headquarters to put those in.
But, and now more than ever, some of the majority of that has been pushed to the website, so you can get your permits online now.
Right.
Mm. Okay. Okay.
Yeah, and that date was November 15th that we opened it up
okay.
for the following year, for 2024.
Yeah.
So.
And I think another thing we got to emphasize again, because I think one of you, correct me if I'm wrong, because it's a place that you can actually volunteer. I mean, I think one of you started off as volunteering and just ventured off from there.
I think, did you start as a volunteer?
Okay, one of y'all. But that opportunity is there, though.
Yes.
Oh, we have a whole department of volunteer resources.
Yeah.
Yeah, again, on our website, you can go and just, you know, click and volunteer. And there's so many different ways you can volunteer. You know, if you want to, if you live near Dan Ryan Woods and you really care about it and you want to help take care of it, that's a volunteer position.
Yeah.
You know, become a site steward for Dan Ryan Woods.
Yeah.
But there's many other ways you can volunteer.
And so also, like, so when you decide to become a volunteer, you create a profile for yourself mm-hmm. online, and every time you do a volunteer act, you earn some kind of point that you eventually get a swag item after you say, oh, I was at this location, I did litter pickup, because that's what that volunteer opportunity was for.
Yeah.
And you report that, how many hours you did, you get a point for it, and you can earn a reward for it. The volunteer opportunities are good for students that are trying to get service learning hours as well.
Yeah.
You know, so, and groups usually sign up as a whole group as well. So you might get 15 to 20 youth coming out with a teacher to do some type of volunteer task. And so again, it is important to go through the website. If you're a group leader and you're trying to take a whole group, someone from our from that department will reach out to you and discuss what this volunteer opportunity is, and then they'll go from there. Because also, I do believe that there's an opportunity for transportation for the volunteer opportunity.
When you say to pick them up?
For the group, yes,
okay.
To pick them up.
And you know, I think that's something else I just thought about. Because again, with us as black people, we have a lot of black people that's concerned about, you know, the nature and the environment and how it looks and everything. And we're willing to go out and volunteer. And I think that's a myth that needs to be rebuked also, because there's a lot of people out there. Of course, there's job opportunity that we can talk about later on, but there are a lot of people who are generally concerned that we'll get out there and we'll help volunteer. But I see you want to jump in.
No, I just remembered what you said. I did share the story of a young man who started out volunteering with the Forest Preserve. You know, he was a teenager, and the teacher took him and his class out and said, hey, if we're going to do some restoration work, we'll provide lunch. And he says, oh, lunch, great. Goes out, and they cleared up this whole area. He had his lunch, and then right before they left, the teacher said, hey, look behind you. Remember, it was a bunch of buckthorn there? Look at it now, it's all gone. And from that point on, he saw the change that he made. And fast forward, he's been with the Forest Preserve right now for about 6 or 7 years.
Okay.
He went through our youth program. Now he's been on staff for about 6 or 7 years, full-time salary, all because of that experience as a student and then the volunteer and so forth.
It
changes lives coming out volunteering.
Absolutely.
And that also speaks to our mission. We really want to connect people to their forest preserves, you know, because it is their resource. They're the taxpayer, they own it. So we want to connect them with it and connect them with nature as a whole, you know.
Yeah.
And I think it's going to be beneficial to them health-wise. In all kind of ways.
Let's talk about that before you talk about the job opportunities, but health-wise, I mean, I think that's something that needs to be emphasized as well. We talked about it on previous shows. We touched on it last time. We kind of alluded to it now, but really that therapy, I mean, just to be able to get out there, you know, and just to be with nature. I mean, again, I have to reference myself. During those warmer days, I'm out walking. You're walking, but then it's like when that sun hits you, and it's like, man, you know, it's a different
your
feeling.
Your body wants it, you know.
Yeah.
It's all natural.
Yeah.
It's all natural.
And to walk around that facility, you know, everybody for the most part is cordial. It's just a nice environment. Just you get a chance to reflect, and you appreciate so much, you know, just being out there, even just to, you know, the colors of the leaves and the trees and everything. It's just something about it. It's relaxing. It's just it gets me excited, you know, about the day. You know, but that's just me. But I think it's I think it's something. I had a friend here the other day, Miosha Thomas, and she served in the military, and she was injured, and she was talking about therapy. She didn't want the therapy to have, you know, as far as talking to someone. Her therapy became art. You know, she started doing art. It was art therapy. And she's going on to, you know, that's been a part of her profession as well. But I think that's something that should be included also, you know, as far as if that's not, you know, I haven't been on the website, so I don't know. But if that's not a part of the
criteria,
I think that should be a part of, you know, that something to offer, you know, somebody, you know, to get out there and let this be a part of their mental recuperation.
Absolutely. We've actually offered programs, Art in Nature.
Yeah.
You know, where people can go out and just draw, you know, landscapes, things like that. So, yeah.
So that is a part of it. Art
in Nature. Oh, yeah. Definitely.
And we have partners that, through our partnership program, they offer programs very similar to that. Sometimes they'll combine painting in nature with yoga and meditation. You know, it's like an hour and a half program.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, that sounds relaxing. I think we got another caller. Oh, go ahead. Before caller, go ahead.
Well, I was just going to add to when you were talking about, you know, walking out and seeing the beauty and everything is also what you're hearing too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So the sounds of the crunching and the leaves, the crickets, the birds, all of that adds to your meditation and relaxation when you're walking.
That's a good point because I know some people out there in the morning, they may have their music with them, may have their headphones on. And that's depending on how you feel. But just like you said, I don't have my phone with me. No music going. That's every blue moon, I may have, you know, be listening to something.
Right.
But for the most part, to hear the leaves crunching, you know, mm-hmm. to see the little squirrels. I've seen black squirrels out there. You know, I didn't even know black squirrels existed, And just to see, you see more when you just unplug from
immersed.
The matrix, as they say.
Immersed. That's what it's about, being completely immersed in nature.
Absolutely.
You want to use all the senses that you have.
Yeah. And then they're all out there, from the smell, to the sight, the hearing. Mm-hmm. It's just, you know what I wanted to bring up, and caller, we're coming to you. The last time I was out there, it was a little chilly out there. I told one of my brothers, it was five, I meant to show this to you, I got it on my phone. They looked like parrots. They were green birds, they flew on the ground, you know, a little feet away. I stopped and I filmed them. I wish I had the footage to show it. It's on my phone though, but I couldn't believe it because they looked like parrots. It was two that stayed, remained on the ground. It was three that went up in the tree.
Hmm.
And I was concerned because it was cold out there. I was like, man, are they going to be able to survive?
That's an exciting thing because you'd be surprised the diversity of animals and birds that we have right here in Illinois.
Yeah.
Now, I don't know what those were, but there's a huge diversity of birds in this region.
It stopped me in my tracks. It definitely stopped me in my tracks. And I happened to have my phone with me. Yeah. And I took my phone out, and I did. I was able to film and get a couple of pictures.
And if you do take a picture of a bird, you could bring it to one of our nature centers.
I got it. I can show it to you after.
Would know what that bird is.
Thank God for post editing. We still got that caller. Caller, you are on the air.
Yes, sir. Enjoying the show.
Yes, sir.
My brother with the green shirt, he's so expressive with his hand. And I really get the message, you know. But I don't want him to cover his face when he do that, because if you do TV somewhere else, you're kind of covering your face.
Thank you.
You must be expressive from the chin down. We want to see your handsome face there, black brother. And not only that, I would like to know, I heard you mention snowmobiling. Do you bring your own snowmobile, or do y'all have snowmobile rentals? And how does that kind of work? And once again, fabulous job, fabulous career choice, my man. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, sir. Either one.
Thank you. I'll speak to that. So we don't rent snowmobiles.
Okay.
So if you have your own snowmobiles, there are trails that you can use, some of those multi-use trails I talked about earlier. So again, they would need to go to the website and just type in snowmobiling, or just go to things to do, and snowmobiling will be under there.
Okay.
And they click on it, and you can get all the rules for snowmobiling.
Yeah.
They'll need to know trail etiquette once again.
Yeah, right now, for snowmobiling and even with horseback riding, it's like we're just destinations.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, that's good enough.
Yeah.
You can tell I bring it up all the time with the zip liners. Now, is that year-round, or is that seasonal?
It's seasonal.
Seasonal, yeah. It's called Go Ape.
And the pond attendant.
So, they're a company that leased the Forest Preserve space.
Okay.
It's high ropes courses, zip line.
Yeah, you mentioned
but
the
it is
high
seasonal.
Rope.
Yeah,
five levels.
Yeah.
You know, it's okay if you can only make it through level three, but when you go back again, you can eventually go through all five levels.
I'm not even sure what you're talking about. I'm curious, though, and I definitely have to see it in this lifetime. So I have to utilize these.
If you like physical fitness in any kind of way, it'll be a good challenge for you.
Okay.
Yeah.
Like an obstacle course.
Yeah, exactly.
On in air.
Yeah.
Obstacle course in air.
Yeah.
But you're safely strapped to something.
Right.
So you have to overcome some fear also.
That's right.
Being up in there.
Yeah.
Interesting. We had touched on the job opportunities also, because I mean, you had mentioned earlier, and this is something else I didn't know, that the Forest Preserve, the offices are open 7 days a week. So that means somebody got to be there.
The Nature Center's open
Nature Center
7 days a week.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a Nature Center in every zone, north, south,
central,
northwest, and southeast. You're really southeast. Yeah, and southwest as well, yeah.
And there's so many, again, being out there, you see so much. There's so many opportunities. You got the Forest Preserve Police. You got the people who clean up. And the Dan Ryan Woods, I mean, it's one of the cleanest places I've seen, you know.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you get the people who clean up. I'm pretty sure you got the people who do the...
We get all kinds of
departments. Maintain the grass and
that's right.
the shrubber and everything. So talk mm-hmm. about some of the other opportunities, job-wise.
You know, with the Forest Preserve, it depends on the different departments that we have, what jobs are going to be available. So within our own SEP department, Conservation Experiential Programming, do we have anything coming up? But basically, we have both. Sometimes we have part-time and full-time positions
yeah,
coming up.
I think the next thing would be the YLA.
So we have a summer program called Youth Outdoor Ambassadors, mm-hmm. where we hire young people between the ages of 16 and 22. When these young people are hired on, we hire up to at least 22 of them. Some of them are placed at nature centers where they learn what it means to be a junior naturalist. You get to work with the animals on site. You get to help with educational programs that are geared towards the public. And also these young people are placed with some of our zone teams where they're, again, doing different types of events and activities for the different for the public. And it's all paid 40 hours a week, typically 9 to 5 or 8 to 4 hours. And this particular position is going to be posted around February, end of February, March. And right now it pays 16 something an hour.
Mm-hmm. Okay, nice.
I mean, there's more to say about it, but I'll just end it there because it's a really good program and there's a good long-term component to it.
But you know, it's a lot to offer there. I mean, even the Forest Preserve, that's almost, I mean, the Cook County is, you know, it's a government itself, but it's almost like the Cook County Forest Preserve is an entity within itself. You know, yep. they have their own budget. I don't know if you all, politically, I'm trying to get you into the politics, but I don't know if you ever have to go to any of the meetings or the hearings or anything, but, you know, they have their own budget. I mentioned their own police and everything. So it's like, it's a lot that's entailed, yeah. that goes yeah. with with Cook County Forest Preserve.
And, you know, and just to connect the two again, like, so even when we're talking about these young people or jobs, because we have 11 different departments, all departments tend to hire at some point throughout the year.
Right.
So if you're not someone who wants to be a quote-unquote tree hugger, really out there working with nature, there are these other departments that are, like in our IT department, that are working with computers.
Yep.
But they're still pushing the mission of conservation and taking care of nature.
Yeah.
But they're not out there like everyone else.
And you just mentioned 11 departments.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just in the Forest Preserve.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
I mean, some of our departments are downtown. Mm. You know, like our finance department is downtown. IT is stationed downtown as well. So as Cree said, you don't have to be outside. Not all of our jobs are outdoors.
Right. Yeah.
You know, a great deal of them are, but not all of them.
Yeah. Yeah.
So,
but there is room in there for those that just they're passionate about nature.
Oh, yeah.
And wants
yeah.
to get involved. So absolutely. Yeah. So, yeah, man, this has been great. We breathed by this one, this interview right here, man. But we only got about two, three minutes left before we shut it down. So I mean, as we begin to wind down. Is there anything else that I mean, it's so much. We, you know, I Dr. King Day of Service, you know, that's coming up in January. Yeah. You want to mention that?
Yeah, I just wanted to let everyone know and this is part of my closing statement too, go to our website, www.fpdcc.com. Look up the different type of events that we're offering. Especially at our different locations, we are celebrating Dr. Martin Luther King Day of Service. Most locations will be doing either restoration work, litter pickup, and we will be providing different types of educational information about Dr. King himself. So please go to the website, learn about what we're doing, and come out there, not just with yourself as an individual, but bring a group along.
Mm, yeah. Yeah, and do you want to say about that?
I wanted to bring it back to Dan Ryan Woods, you know, because we all know about Dan Ryan Woods.
Mm-hmm.
There are other things going on at Dan Ryan Woods during the winter.
Okay.
For instance, we got a Kwanzaa celebration coming up December 26th through the 1st. Mm-hmm. There'll be music, nature-based activities there. Also, if you're a senior, we've got the Mingle in the Morning is what we call it, Senior Walking Club. You can come and mingle with other seniors and go on wellness walks and just enjoy the outdoors together. And that's on Wednesdays through December, January, and February. And then also s'mores, if you want to. We've got a teen s'mores night. That's January the 12th right there, Dan Ryan Woods. So nice. It's a lot going on there.
Yeah, well, excellent. So, man, I really appreciate you you all coming in. Just you close the statement. Go ahead, plug it up.
Being respectful of time. My brother was talking about me. He's talking with my hands. We're having a winter bonfire December 16th at Sand Ridge Nature Center from 4 to 8. I would be one of the storytellers there out in front. So if you really want to see me get animated with my hands,
be there.
Yes, sir. Excellent. Excellent. Any closing words?
I just say check us out. Check out the website. So much to see, so much to do, so much to learn.
Yeah.
And it belongs to you. So
yeah, that's the important part. Get out there and utilize it. Yeah. Stop driving by it.
That's right.
And it's more than just a family reunion or fraternity party. That's right. You can do a whole lot more. Look, it's every time I think it's nothing more to talk about, you all never cease to amaze me. I really thank you all for coming out. So, and I know we'll see you all sooner than later.
Thank you so much for having us. Thank you.
Look, on behalf of our dear brothers, Credell Walls and Arthur Matthews, on behalf of the CROE co-founders, the CROE membership, the CROE Media Production Team, I'm Brother Mandeen T. Muhammad. May Allah continue to bless you with the light of understanding as I greet you in peace. Assalamu alaikum.